gentlemen, Angela Lansbury.
When I think about Katharine Hepburn, so many things come to my mind, images. Her New England honesty and forthrightness, her unique style and brilliant originality. But I suppose most of all, I think of the one quality which sets her apart more than any other. She is a true American eccentric. Now, please understand, by that I don't mean strange or quirky. Although, one is reminded of those moments, such as the time she was told by the heads of RKO that no self-respecting actress would ever wear dungarees in public. She told them she agreed completely, stripped them off and strolled through the lot in her undergarments. But when I describe her as an eccentric, I am referring to the strict Webster definition of the term, that which deviates from a circular path or orbit, located somewhere other than at geometric center. That truly is Kate. I worked with her only once. It was in 1948. The film was The State of the Union. I was barely past my teens and absolutely terrified. But she welcomed me and challenged me, and in that brief time together, taught me more about the actor's craft, possibilities, and generosity than anyone before or since. Thank you, dear Kate, for that. When she was a child, over the mantel of her family's fireplace was inscribed, "Listen to the song of life." She has surely done that, and in the process, written a new song of strength and individualism for the rest of us to hear as well.
I think I was born at a time that was enormously suitable for my personality. And I think I was born of two people who were really fascinating. I'm a total product, every day that I live, every performance I give, of them. If I had to put it in one word, I think they gave me freedom from fear.
Life was something she would take on her terms. So was acting. In New York, the few small parts she landed, she usually lost for talking back to the directors. But with the right starring role, she was overpowering. Hollywood made an offer. Unimpressed with the movies, she named an outrageous price and told them, take it or leave it. She strode into town, said a director, and changed our notion of what an actress could be.
When I come in... What is the matter with you?
Well, you see,
Do you realize that you're making a perfect fool of yourself? Now, look here, you can't tell me that I'm your coat. There's such a thing as being... Will you please stop doing that with your hat?
I never...
In the world is going on
here? No, please don't move.
Oh, I've had about enough of this.
Now, look, listen to me. Let's get out of here. Just start walking.
So now you want to walk. Well, I'm quite sure that I don't want to walk with you. And I hope you realize that you've made a perfect spectacle of yourself. Have you finished?
Yes.
Hello, Mother. Hello, Dad. Hello, Kate. Calla lilies are in bloom again. Such a strange flower, suitable to any occasion. I carried them on my wedding day, and now I place them here in memory of something that has died.
He needs a good thrashing.
You poor child.
Are you gathered here to mourn, or have you come to bring me comfort? You know, there's still something not quite right about that line.
You might learn to read it correctly. That would help.
I don't see why you should object to an intelligent suggestion.
I've written several important plays, Miss Randall. One of them received the Pulitzer Prize. Have you written any plays?
Well, there's an old saying that you don't have to be a hen to know a bad egg.
Feminine and flinty, she was something of a shock. Kate had very definite ideas about what she ought to be doing. The studios had their own ideas. Miscast and misused, she was labeled box office poison. Not gonna stick around for this, she huffed. She bought out her contract, went back east, and found a property that would take her to Broadway. With the public half hoping she would fall off her high horse, she began to rework her part with the playwright. Scared stiff, she was damned if she'd let anyone know it. The Philadelphia Story was about a society brat brought down to earth by love. She sold herself and the movie rights back to Hollywood.
Good morning. Stop that music. I'm terribly sorry to have kept you waiting, but there's been a slight hitch in the proceedings. I've made a terrible fool of myself, which isn't unusual. And my fiancé, he thinks we better call it a day. And I quite agree with him.
Peace is wonderful.
Dexter, what next?
2 years ago, I did you out of a wedding in this house by eloping to Maryland.
2 years ago? You were invited to a wedding.
Just
in this
alone.
House.
Yeah, put the swing in your best pocket. Don't have a plan. Then hold in your hand. Which was very bad manners. But I hope to make it up to you by going through with it now as originally planned.
Beautifully through with it now, as originally and most beautifully planned.
So if you just keep your seats for a minute. That's all.
That's all.
He's waiting for you.
Come in, Sam. Come in. Haven't you met Miss Harding?
Yes, yes, in a belligerent sort of way.
He hit me first. Hello.
Tracy and Hepburn, they were the unlikeliest perfect pair.
If you think you're going to turn a court of law into a Punch and Judy show,
darling,
I want to tell
please,
you, you don't...
Please, this means a great deal to me.
Yes, would you?
And
would
it's
you,
not
would,
a stunt.
Would you?
This
would
poor
you,
woman, isn't yes. she entitled to the same justice? I mean, that's usually reserved for men. The same unwritten law that got Lenihan off.
Would you?
I know what
please,
you're going to say.
Please,
that he
please,
should have been convicted,
just,
too, but he wasn't.
Couldn't
and
I,
you're not going to put this
just,
poor girl away
yes,
just because she had the misfortune
small,
to be born a
just
female.
Just one word in
not,
it.
If I could
wise,
help it.
Couldn't
what?
I? Could I please get a word in edgewise? Well, miss?
Yes, Mr. Allnut.
How'd you like it?
Like it?
White water, rapid.
I never dreamed.
I don't blame you for being scared, miss. Not one little bit. Ain't no person in their right mind ain't scared of white water.
I never dreamed that any mere physical experience could be so stimulating.
And there is nothing, absolutely nothing, that your son feels for my daughter that I didn't feel for Christina. Old? Yes. Burned out? Certainly. But I can tell you, the memories are still there. Clear, intact, indestructible. And they'll be there if I live to be 110. Where John made his mistake, I think, was attaching so much importance to what her mother and I might think. Because in the final analysis, it doesn't matter a damn what we think. The only thing that matters is what they feel and how much they feel for each other. And if it's half of what we felt, that's everything.
After lunch, after we've gobbled up all those silly strawberries, we'll take ourselves to the old town road. We've been there a thousand times, darling. A thousand. And you'll remember it all. Listen to me, mister. You're my knight in shining armor. Don't you forget it. You're gonna get back on that horse. And I'm gonna be right behind you, holding on tight. And away we're gonna go, go, go.
I don't like horses.
I know myself pretty goddamn well. And I couldn't, except with laughter, think of myself as a legend.
Ladies and gentlemen, Lauren Bacall and Ben Close.
She looks a fright, her manner is objectionable, and she has no talent.
She runs the gamut of emotions from A to B.
She can show no emotion except by dilating her nostrils.
That's what they were saying about her 60 years ago.
My mother encouraged me to live in the image of George Bernard Shaw and have a colorful life. She picketed the White House for women's suffrage and delivered speeches on street corners. My first real thrilling job was filling balloons that said, "Votes for Women."
My father taught me how to deal with overly male men. Don't react, just say yes, then don't pay any attention.
Young Kate was a tomboy. It never occurred to her that she was an inferior sex, just a different sex.
I could outdive, outswim, and outrun anyone.
She shaved her head so she wouldn't be at a disadvantage when wrestling.
At RKO, she wore trousers and refused to coo like a starlet. They called her Catherine of Arrogance.
Said the director, George Stevens, "She can be rude, but no more than any other woman who's definite. She just says things without adding the grace note."
Said the director, George Cukor, "She wasn't a screen actress yet by any means. But she had the same thing then as she has now, precision."
Tennessee Williams put it this way: "Kate is a playwright's dream. She makes dialogue sound better than it is by a clarity of diction and by a fineness of intelligence that illuminates every shade of meaning in every line she speaks."
Kate said, "Acting isn't very difficult. I mean, Shirley Temple could do it at four."
She first met Spencer Tracy on the set of Woman of the Year. She said, "I'm afraid I'm a little tall for you."
"Don't worry," Tracy answered. "I'll cut you down to size."
Certain characteristics of mine were wildly irritating to him. So I gave up some of the qualities I most admired in myself. I stopped being loud and bossy. Oh, all right, I was still loud and bossy, but only behind his back.
To me, his acting was the real stuff that life is made of. It was pure concentration, the mind's truth and the heart's truth, unembroidered, like a clipper ship in action.
1951, the African Queen. I know the whole story. The producer, Sam Spiegel, told Bogey he had Houston and Hepburn. And he told Houston he had Bogart and Hepburn. And he told Hepburn he had Bogart and Houston before he had any of them. And that's how he got all of them.
Said John Houston, Katie was being rather stern and stiff with the part. So I told her it should be played not as a schoolmistress, but as a great lady. You know, chin up, onward, ever onward. Katie asked me, what great lady? So I had to think. And I said, Eleanor Roosevelt.
That was the goddamnedest best piece of direction I have ever heard. He just told me exactly how to play that part.
She won her third Oscar for playing Eleanor of Aquitaine in The Lion in Winter.
Eleanor of Aquitaine had lived at a time when women had few significant rights. She had enormous intelligence and titanic energy, and presented an image of womanhood at variance with a subordinate role ordained by her sex.
When the script for the film version of The Lion in Winter came to Peter O'Toole, he said, it occurred to me that there was only one actress on the face of the earth who could play Eleanor of Aquitaine. So I sent her the script, and the telephone rang within days, and the voice said, do it before I die.
I think the reason that people have an affection for me now is that I have lived a life a lot of women think would have been a nice life to have lived, dignified but free. They think I've done what I wanted to do. They don't bother to think that they might have five kids and I don't. But I have brains enough to know you can't have it all. You just can't.
These words by her idol, George Bernard Shaw, could have been written for and about Katharine Hepburn. People are always blaming their circumstances for what they are. I don't believe in circumstances. The people who get on in this world are the people who get up and look for circumstances they want. And if they can't find them, make them.
Thank you, Kate.